Hello, hello, hello. Welcome to the Diggler Digest. I'm your host, Cream Diggler, and I am here with my co-host to my whatever side this is, right or left, Junior Boy, how are you today?
Yeah. Be annoying.
Okay, and then below us with his great lighting is Elderberry Swag. I have light envy.
Don't have light envy.
It's a whole mood down there.
Lighting. His looks so like.
Yeah, like I'm overlit. I can't fucking figure it out. Like, what is the?
I'll do a little backlight to try to give me a little three dimension back here.
Like, I don't know. I need help. I need assistance.
Yeah,
it's either too much or not enough. I don't know. Well, it's good to see y'all. It has been a hell of a week this week for me. How about for y'all? How has your week been this week?
It was okay.
Mine has been very interesting. I hope you're going to get into what I think you're going to get into because we need to discuss.
We got so much to discuss. So let's just get on into it. This is. Let's see, where am I trying to go? I'm trying to go here, and I'm trying to say this is season 2, episode 11. Yes. Okay. Thank y'all for joining us. Turn it on or turn it off, is what we're going to look at here. We got first show. For the love of Dilfs. Now, Swag has talked about this show before and turned to like encouraging us to watch For the Love of Dilfs. And I must admit, Swag, when it was first mentioned, I was like, another reality show? I don't know. And I was bored one Saturday. Right. And I wanted some gay shit to watch. I said, sometimes you're just in the mood for some gay shit.
Mm-hmm.
And y'all know what I'm talking about. Are you ever just in the mood to watch some gay shit?
Like, yeah, yes. Gay things.
Yeah,
bald headed shit. Like what you?
So I said, let me turn on this show. It's on Out TV through Amazon, and I started watching it, and I was enjoying myself. Like I was. Into Stormy Daniels is there who's hosting it. Stormy, mm-hmm. she's at first she's a little rough around that. She's a little not quite as natural. There's two seasons out now. She's in hosting season 2. So much better in season 2 she is. Mm-hmm. But even the rockiness, she was still endearing. You know, you could tell she's here for the gays. Right. I like the little bits of her. Huh?
What does DILF stand for? What does that stand for?
DILF stands for
Daddy's, Dad, I'd like to. Yeah.
Right?
You want to say it again?
Daddy's, I'd like to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's taken from the MILFs, the derivative of MILFs.
I got you. Yes. That's what I was trying to figure out. Like, I knew that what the other part was. I was trying to figure out the D part.
Yeah, daddies, yeah. Yeah, so the premise of this show, sorry guys, the premise of this show is they bring in a group of, let's say, 6 DILFs, men who are probably 40 plus, and then they bring in a group of himbos who are, himbos, who are like 21, between 21 to, I don't think nobody was like maybe 35, maybe 21, 35.
Oh no, yeah, they were probably all like
under 30,
21, 22, yeah, maybe 25 at the oldest, right?
Yeah, and they are there to date for love, to find love, and there's different contests that where they're voting each other off or getting voted off, and the prize is. $10,000, yes, $10,000. To be split, and so it's just an interesting show. So, Swag, what do you think about the show?
I mean, I love the show because it's kind of a take on all the other dating shows that we've seen out there. And you're right, Stormy Daniels is, she's. I mean, let's face it. I think based on her career, like hosting a reality show is probably not one of her stronger points. But you know, the gays love her, and you know, she loves the gays. So, but I do kind of like the premise of, like, you know, these daddies with, like, these himbos, and you know, trying to see, like, what happens, and you know, it gets messy, which, you know, I love some messy TV. So, I really did enjoy it. So I had heard about it. I was like, let me see what this is about. And it's quite entertaining. If you want some gay shit to just, you know.
Yes.
It's a good laugh.
Huh?
Yes.
Gay guys?
Yeah. Yes, all gay guys. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's so gay on gay.
And they're looking for sugar daddies.
No. Yes. They're not looking for sugar daddy. Looking for mature men of a certain age.
Oh, is that what we call it?
Who are daddies? They're not necessarily looking for nobody to take care of them. Mm-hmm. I guess. You know, some of them are.
I'm sure. Maybe, but you know.
But it's very interesting because I mean, I do believe there's been at least a couple of couples who really did fall in love, and it's interesting to watch people who. To have that kind of process fast forwarded in the gay world, right? Mm-hmm. That whole, does he like me? Is he? Because they have opportunities to pick other people. They bring in new people, and like you be two episodes, you with somebody, and all of a sudden they bring in somebody new, and you get a chance. You might get a chance to switch, you know. And
right,
and some people are like, some people really embrace that because they're like, well, that's what we're here for. We're here to find our person, and how you find somebody, you date. You don't just necessarily settle down. The first person who chose you, and so right. Of course that's always controversial and things like that. So,
and some of them like to be messy, and there are there's one on here who is really really messy. Like he is there to cause chaos and just you know, I won't give it away. But like if you get to watch, you will know who I'm talking about. Yeah.
And season two is just as messy. Tears, crying every episode. Now, there was one episode in season two, I actually had tears running down my face. Because I'm going to tell you, because there was this moment, because there's a couple that is really into each other. I'm not going to tell you what's happening, but I'm just going to say, everyone assuming that they're the power couple, they're the couple to be, they're going to make it all the way. But then they bring in somebody new, and one of the couple members selects the new person. And I'm not going to tell you what happens as a result of that, but honey, the drama, the tears, I thought you were mine. You said, you told me, you know.
Right.
Is this the show that you were telling me about, that guy that we know that he's on?
Yes, it is. It is that show, yes. The big black bear who was in season one.
Yeah.
Tony, I think was his name. Mm-hmm. He did a good job. And in the show, he was like, the guy he was talking to said something about topping him. He was like, oh, no, you're not going to top me. I was like, girl, get in the modern era.
24.
Okay. The 20s are verse, okay? The 20 girls are verse. At least a taste, girl.
And I think that's the dichotomy of this situation, because, like, you know, some of the older ones are like, nope, that's the way I've always been. I'm not doing that, and I'm not doing this new age stuff. Like, this is what I know, you know.
I ain't gonna be doing
depending, you know?
He had more personality in the show than in real life.
Yes, that's what I thought too. I agree. Mm-hmm. From what I've observed, I thought he represented himself well and so. But I didn't think I think the problem for me is they're not having enough bear himbos, right? They kind of have a guy who's thick in season two, but who's a himbo. But they need to do better on that part.
Yeah. You know?
Himbos are the 20s guys. The guys in the 20s.
Oh, instead of twinks,
they're the gay.
They're not
himbos,
twinks,
but yeah, oh,
Lord.
They're like, you know, they're like go-go boys, and you know, they're hairless, and you know,
yeah, they're different things. Influencers,
you know, they most likely have OnlyFans, you know,
right? But. those girls,
yes.
All right, let's move on. So y'all check out check that show out. For the love of DILFs. Okay, here we go. Let me do that. Bring it back. Okay, so the next one, Jerrit Carmichael's reality show. Jerrit Carmichael reality show. This is on HBO Max. We're on episode 3 as of today, so it's not too late for you to get caught up if you're not watching this. I just want to start off by saying that while I am not necessarily a fan of Jerrit Carmichael, I'm a fan of this show because it's an interesting study in the modern gay man, the modern gay black man, because he's on Grindr. He is having hookups. He's lying to people. He's standing his friends up. He's cheating on his man. He's really exposing himself. Huh? Right. What'd you say?
I said a typical gay.
He's being a typical gay on camera. We don't really see it like this, but then he's also having these reflection moments on stage about some of his shit. Like, girl, we got to get into this moment right here. I mean, I didn't videotape it, but there's a moment where he is talking about he got invited to one of his best friend's wedding. Okay. Uh-huh. The man said, you need to go to Men's Warehouse and pick up your tux. Jerrit Carmichael decides, I'm not going to Men's Warehouse to get no tux. I'm going to go to Tom Ford and get my tux. Okay. He shows up to the wedding dressed maybe 2 hours before the wedding. And the groom is looking at him like, why aren't you wearing a black shirt? Jerrit Carmichael has on a white shirt. What do you mean? You're all supposed to be wearing black shirt. Did you not go to a Men's Warehouse and get the outfit? And he looks at his feet. Them ain't the shoes either.
Lord have mercy.
So Jerrit Carmichael leaves and goes to go shopping to get his thing. He looking for shirts. He looking for shit. Child. He sees a black shirt. I'm going to have to wear this. I mean, this is how you... Do y'all got any Tom Ford? Whoever he's talking to. Like, flash forward, they say an hour after the wedding, he arrives. He arrives just in time to take a picture with the wedding party. And then then flash forward to him talking about, I haven't spoken to my friend since. He's not returning my phone calls.
I wonder why his friend wouldn't do that.
Like, child, and then one of his best friends from high school came. You know, the friend who you promised that if one of us make it, we're gonna bring the other one up. So she came, she wants to be an actress. He done kicked that bitch out of his apartment, gave her apartment. He talked to another friend. Well, she don't know I only got the apartment for a month. She think he done got her apartment in New York. And she only got an apartment for a month. And she trying to be an actress and stuff. She went to audition for something. The guy was like, it was a scene for Macbeth. He says, you know Macbeth, right? No, I don't know Macbeth. He said, who are you? You don't know Macbeth. And that's what I said too. Girl, who are you? You don't know Macbeth. And you trying to be an actress. Okay. But anyway.
Rick.
It's interesting. Does Jerrit and his brother, his best friend, make up? He starts calling all his friends who he's been neglecting, and girl, the reads that he's getting on that phone, the reads, the people are reading him. One person says, "You're not even that famous to be acting like this." Okay. You know, it's just girl, the reads. But so I'm just trying to say, it's worth the watch. It's better than anything he's done. It's better than his stand up. It's better than him hosting. The Oscars, did he have the Oscars that he hosted? Or the Emmys? He hosted something that he bombed. It's better than anything. What we're talking about there, Sammy, we are talking about the Jerrit Carmichael's reality show. Yeah.
I think when he posted that, though, we were talking about Dill. So.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the gay one.
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about. Okay, sorry. There you go.
Right.
For the love of DILFs on Out TV via Amazon, please get into her.
Yeah.
Getting
back to this for a second, you know, I know you're saying that, like, you know, it's I don't know that I could watch this. Like, just what you just told me, it's just like, I don't know if I want to watch this or not, because it's just like, how are you going to be this much of a dick to, like, your friends and stuff? Like, it just, I don't know. Now I will say I think we all owe him an apology, because, like, the whole, like, race thing, like, I get it now. It's like he was saying that's just the way he felt. He not saying that, like, that's actually what he does. But, you know, I saw somebody talk about this the other day. They said, you know, he's talking about, you know, I just hate this shit because, like, y'all taking it out of context. And it's like, but it's your joke.
I don't think we took it out of context. I think he was, I don't think we took it out of context.
Right. It's like, I mean, you decided to tell this. You decided to make yourself the slave. You decided to make your boyfriend the master. Like, we all know what that means. It's like, that shit just wasn't funny. So, I don't know. I want to give it a chance, but it's just like, child, I don't know. I've been so disappointed with stuff lately. It's just like, I don't know if I got the stomach for this bullshit. So I might try to watch it. I already feel some kind of way based on what you just told me.
Give it a watch. It's an interesting study in human behavior. His best friend, I think I told you all this, his best friend, or one of his friends, on the first episode has a mask on and so you can't tell who he is because he don't want to be that. And he's like, why are you doing this? This is like so self-masturbatory to in a public way to do this. And I'm like, dude, get over yourself. It's reality TV. This is what people do. Like, you know,
that's true. Plus I heard that, like, he's sucking on some toes, and I'm just like,
girl, yes, he is.
And it's not the foot thing that I'm got an issue with. It's like, but why they gotta be white toes?
They white toes. They hook up toes, girl. They're not even boyfriend toes, girl. They hook up toes.
See,
but watch and judge. But also you watch, and honestly, I saw my single self in him too. I did. I saw some of my old ways in there. So I was kind of judging him, but also judging me.
Oh, I can only imagine that.
So,
we want to leave room for growth, and that's what you hope for most people to do. But it's just like, I can't.
Oh, Sammy. So I read that.
Please tell me that was a drag queen and not a cis woman. That's Stormy Daniels. If we're talking about the cover of For the Love of Dilf, that's Stormy Daniels who's hosting. So
Trump's ex. Or whatever you want to call it. Trump's ex.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Sammy says, don't you know, since Gerard has come out with that race role playing shit, I've had two white guys online try to shit with me. Oh no!
Open the floodgate.
He done started some shit. Now it's like, we got to fight. Like, no, we are not. That is not what we do. Sounds like some self reflection there.
It is. It was, Sammy. It was. It was a little bit. Just.
I mean, we've all been there or a time or two. But you know, again, you know, there's room for growth and. The change, and you know, hopefully he will find his way, but child, I don't know.
Okay, here our next show, Good Times. Good Times is playing on Netflix, and you know, this show has been mentioned a few times on the network, you know, because I don't know. We love riding in various lanes. You can't help. Hey, people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Beep, moving over into your lane.
Yes.
Your lane. But, anyway.
He's one of the executive producers of this.
Yes. Yes.
How dare he?
But you know who else was in this? Masai, what's her name? Masai, the girl from Blackish. She's an actress in this, ain't she? I was rating that Masai. You got the girl from
Cree Summers in Cree this.
Summers. Yes, the woman from Cree Summers.
I think Yvette Nicole Brown is
Yvette
in this.
Nicole Brown is in there. Mm-hmm. There's a comedian who's voicing the daddy. The comedian who's voicing the daddy. I'm forgetting his name. Yes, Gilly hated it. Hated it. I felt like I gave her a good 5 minutes, maybe three to 5 minutes. I can't remember, but it was just, nothing redeeming, no redeeming qualities, and not funny. You know, I don't mind some stereotypes, like the way Boondocks would play into some stereotypes and stuff, but the stuff was funny. Like, I don't mind satire. I don't mind poking fun. Thank you, Sammy. Thank you, Sammy. JB Smooth. Now listen, yeah. JB Smooth sound like a halfway, like he a slave on anything he do. So on Larry David's show, Curb Your Enthusiasm, I love that show, but it took me a while just to kind of get over the fact that JB Smooth was in there, because he just sounds so like the way we don't want to be seen among the whites. He sounds like that. That's like he's the person you'd be like, oh girl, not she's not gonna get up and talk in front of everybody, is she? Not her. You know, she sounded like a whole watermelon fell out of her mouth every time she talked.
That's
true. And I can say that because I'm black. So, Swag, you gave it a whole episode?
I gave it a whole episode. And I like you, after the first 5 minutes, I wanted to shut it off because I'm like, okay, here we go. And I, you know, it was, there's nothing redeeming about this show. Like, every single stereotype was shoved into that first episode. And I'm like, okay, I can kind of see what they were trying to do, you know, invoke JJ, invoke Michael and a couple of these characters. Where's Thelma? Because last time I checked, Thelma wasn't no drug dealing baby that I remember. It's just, you know, the titty jokes are bad, talking, you know, rats and vermin and flies. It's like I made a TikTok about this today. I said, look, and I said, I'm glad the energy we had for Magical Negroes, we need to have that same energy for this bullshit. I said, because this is just trash. This is so bad. Yeah. And I want to say, like, who was in the room when they thought this up? It was like, yeah, this is something that people will like. People love this.
It's a good idea. The reboot is a good idea. It's the writer's room where we're starting to type all this shit out. It's like somebody was scared of talking to somebody. Like, I just can't imagine that black people had any power here in the writer's room.
Now, I don't know if this is true or not, but a lot of people are laying the blame at Seth MacFarlane, you know, because, you know, this is kind of up his alley.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just like, where were we when somebody put this shit together and they thought, yeah, everybody's gonna love this? And it's funny, I like I said, I talked about it on TikTok today, and I actually did say, were any target audience like given input on this? And somebody made a good point. I don't think we were the target audience. Said, you know what? You might have something there, because the bad thing is, I did watch. I'm being 100% honest when I say this. I didn't laugh not one time. Not in the whole episode. Nothing about this made me laugh. I didn't chuckle. I didn't snort. I didn't giggle. Nothing.
Judy boy, you gonna give her a chance?
No. I didn't even give it the previews. I saw the previews and I was like, no. But I thought they was making fun of that show. They were taking it too Mm-hmm. Like,
and that's kind of the other thing like, I don't like about this.
Except to the seventh power, like I just didn't.
Right, like. If they just wanted to do this, like don't attach this to Good Times. Like just you know, call it something new and let that be it. But to attach this to Good Times, I'm like,
how dare you?
Yes, exactly. How dare you?
Hit that up. Go ahead, somebody.
Did Seth MacFarlane have any black people on his staff willing to go against the grain to say this isn't a good idea? You know, it makes you wonder. Like, there probably were some that probably, like, had an issue with it, but they might have been scared to say. And I did say that, like, you know, I don't know when this was done. Like, I don't know if this was, like, before or after the writer's strike. But, like, you know, these people probably needed a check. And they probably was just like, you know what? I wouldn't normally do this, but let's just go ahead.
Hi, John. Hi. How are you? Hello.
Tired, worn out.
You just get what'd you say?
Where are you?
I'm in the big city of Greensboro, North Carolina right now.
Ooh, John's had a death in the family, so he had to take off.
Yeah.
So John, we are finishing up here talking about Good Times. I think we lost him. So we gonna move on to the next. Yeah.
Ellie said he watched three and didn't chuckle, and Ellie says I refuse to waste my time. Absolutely, best.
Yeah.
Don't waste your time on
that. Don't do it. Don't. We did it for you. Okay. We suffered so you don't have to suffer.
Right.
So
don't do it. It's like you in danger, girl. Don't watch this bullshit.
Yeah. Don't watch it. We watched Good Times, so you don't have to watch Good Times. So,
I missed the discussion about Good Times.
You did. Did you watch any of her?
I gave her 22 minutes.
And then you have to, y'all are saints. Three episodes, a whole episode, 22 minutes. Three to five, I couldn't take it no more.
It was too much.
Mm-mm. All right, so Lil Nas X has released some of his music on a SoundCloud, which is giving, I don't know, it's giving like I'm just starting out energy. And I feel like, am I reading too much into this? Is this just, is this a good thing? Is this a bad thing? For me, it's feeling like a bad thing. I feel like because his last single didn't do that well, and it was, you know, kind of tanked a little bit, that he's feeling very insecure right now about his art, and releasing it on SoundCloud is like a low stakes way of putting the music out there. And right. It's kind of harkening back to Old Town Road, which is how that song got first put out.
Right.
What do we think, gentlemen? What do we think?
I mean, I agree. I think it's probably kind of like, you know, beta testing something. Like, let me just put this out here and see what kind of reaction I get without having to, like, fully invest in, you know, all the other things that go into, like, you know, releasing music or something like that. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, he still gets a lot of hate and a lot of, like, you know, just kind of, you know, oh, you gay. It's like, okay, no shit, Sherlock. We know that already, but you know.
I don't know. I think he's trying too hard now at this point. I mean, okay, we know you gay. We got it. We got the memo. We got the t-shirt. I mean, now it's like, like, what else do you want to do? Like, I mean, it's like, you just doing unnecessary stuff to me. Like, it's like, okay.
He's turning into a black Sam Smith.
Mm. Yes, that's he is. Sam Smith is another one doing too much now.
He did start doing too much, didn't he? I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. I think he took us too fast. Sam, we with you, girl, but you taking us too fast, girl. You take it too fast.
Yeah. And there's a part of me that wonders, like, if he does that just to kind of, you know, for the shock value, because, you know, we know a lot of people just do kind of outrageous shit just so, like, you know, they will be trending on Twitter, or, you know, they will be trending on TikTok or whatever. So some of it does feel really performative, and it's just like, okay, you know, just you know, we will support you if you put out good music, but, like, you don't need to do all this, like.
Right. Gilly says the gimmicks have run their course. People ain't, it's, you gotta,
so is this, like, yeah. I was gonna say, he, somebody asked, Sam asked the question, is this supposed to be a straight cover and a gay cover?
Well, this was two different singles. I think the first the single was a little bit more femme, and the second single is a little more mask, I guess. Is the energy that I'm getting? Yeah, that's what it is. What's so funny, John?
Have you listened to the music? Has anybody listened to
either song? I did. I listened to both songs. I mean, you know, I was listening to it on my phone. I wasn't particularly inspired to try to figure out how to download it. So, gotcha. I was like, well, let me record this so that people can hear it, so that they can. I wasn't feeling like that, you know. So.
Gotcha. Okay.
I thought she probably needed a cute music video to tip her over the edge, you know. Maybe. I don't know. I mean, I'm not mad at all this. I'm not mad at any of it, but.
No, I am.
Right.
What you mad at?
I'm mad at all of this.
You bet it, all of this.
Yeah, I mean, I liked him at the beginning, like, when he did it, like, he was still gay, but he still gave that, like for example, like, the, what was that video he did when they was in the jail cell?
Oh, yeah.
Montero.
I like that. Like, that was like, okay, like, you woke the girls up, like, wow, but you know, it seemed like you weren't trying hard. You just like, okay, this is just me, doing me, I'm gonna give y'all something to take. But now it's like, you got this wig on, these nails, this blood, it's not even making sense to me.
No.
You over here giving off trade on the right. I just don't know what's going on. It's like, what are you
saying? That he's both. He's saying on the other side with the long hair, I'm the trans woman who got beat up on the street, and, you know, I'm representing people who like that. And then on the other side, he could be. It's art. It's what you interpreting.
Right.
It's not art.
Okay.
Okay, we'll move on to this. Somebody get that.
Sam Smith lost me when he said he didn't fuck with MJ. Say what now?
MJ who? Michael Jackson?
Yes, that's what he's saying. No, that's the only MJ I know. Yeah, he would have lost me too, honey, if I knew that.
Tried it.
You say. It's Sammy say he got one for trade and one for the girls. Have at it.
Yeah, that's exactly it. That's what he's doing. Now, we all knew, it's like in obvious news, Ashanti announces that she is pregnant. With Nelly's baby, and they engage to get married. Now, well, let's just start there. Congratulations. Can we get we got any congratulations sounds so we get a hand clap? Yeah. Congratulations.
It took a good time to figure out that they was in love with each other when she was when he was married, allegedly.
She conceived it while he was married to another woman, allegedly?
No, when they back in the day.
Oh.
Yes, she was sleeping with him when he was married, allegedly.
Oh, I didn't know Nelly was married before. Oh, okay. I don't know. I don't follow her like that. I just know that she had her dick out on social media with a woman sucking on it. And I was just wondering, would you go back to somebody, to an ex, after you done see him getting guapped on? On the internet. And it's not alleged, because he said, I'm sorry for the woman whose family saw her whopping on me. On the internet. So I'm just wondering, Would you go with somebody who was doing that? Go, your ex got caught getting guapped on with some other chick?
Yeah, she got guapped
out. I mean, if we weren't together at the time, then, you know, I mean, if they, you know, if we're not together and they do that, I mean, you know, that's you know, that's what they do. Now, we were together when that was done, then yeah, I'd be like, no, absolutely not.
Yeah. I think it'd be a turnoff for me. It'd be a turnoff. Go ahead, John.
The bigger question would be, who did it better?
I mean, is it really a question? If he knows his duty, he's gonna be saying, "You did, babe.
You did." I know, right? Nobody does it like you. You know,
right?
Yeah, she was doing it, but I was thinking about you, babe.
I wonder if this is like a Carrie, Mr. Big kind of situation, where, like, you know, Ashanti spent all that hurt. These years running after him and finally let him go, and then he finally came around after he did all that shit he did. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Congratulations, though. Congratulations.
Yeah, I got pregnant. Thank God.
So, in positive news, we're not just about gossip and just, you know, we're about building people up, okay? Beyonce's Blackbird is now the most successful version of the Beatles song in the history of the Billboard Hot 100, because that song has been covered a lot. It's a very popular song. A lot of people love that song. Blackbird in the Middle of Night. You know, all kind of versions.
Yeah. Just like
that. I think so, congratulations. What'd you say?
I think I had to sing it as a show tune in undergrad. I think I had to sing it for like a show tune type of deal we had to do. Yeah,
she's popular, and Shaboozy, the guy who she duetted with on this album, he had his first number one song this week. She debuted with a guy named Shaboozy,
Beyonce, a
country artist. Yeah, Beyonce did. On this new album,
the girls that was from the country.
I'm not talking about Blackbird no more.
Oh,
you're
okay.
Right. She did this song with four girls. Yeah.
Oh.
But okay. I'm talking about another song she did. I forget what song it is. If it's I'm not even gonna say because I'm gonna be lying. But she did another song on the album with a boy named Shaboozy.
Yeah.
The thick, look like horn dreads. Yeah. But he released a song this week and it was number one, or he released it last week and it came number one this week, and he's never had a number one on the chart, so. Congratulations to him. I mean, the Beyonce effect is real, baby. It is so real. it is so real. Tanner Adele, her percentage listens went up. Like,
yeah,
I can't. Don't even give me a line. The girl was on the Today Show this week. Like, the Today Show diction has not been thinking about her ever.
She's like, when a Beyonce.
But thanks to the Beyonce effect, girl. Can you imagine if Beyonce was online doing food reviews like that guy talking about ones to tens when she's eating fried chicken and catfish and mac and cheese? Talking about, oh, this is a 8 now.
You know, one more, she had Popeyes. She had people eating Popeyes for a while.
Did she?
That's her favorite chicken. That's her favorite chicken place.
Child,
Sweet Honey Buckin' is a song with Shaboozy.
Sweet Honey Buckin'. Oh, yeah, Sweet Honey Buckin'. Yeah, oh, right. Yeah, Shaboozy. Although Tanner Adele just released a song too called Whiskey Blues, which is a great song. Mm-hmm. Y'all should go listen to that song, it's good. Whiskey Blues. Tanner Adele. This may be fall into the we don't care category, but I just thought I would throw it out there because it felt very heterosexual to me. It was kind of a turnoff, but I was like, maybe somebody cares. Ed Lover validates that Cat Williams' claim that Steve Harvey, this is reported by the Jasmine brand, Steve Harvey was attempting to take Bernie Mac's role in the film Ocean's 11. Now, it's a role. I don't know how you take somebody's role. It's open. The roles are open for people to audition for and get. I guess maybe Kat, it was promised to Bernie and Kat, and Steve was like, oh, I think I can get it. Is this news, or is Ed Lover just need to be quiet?
I mean, I don't doubt that it's true, but honestly, who cares? Like, yeah, like, you know, he didn't get it, you know.
Welcome to Hollywood.
It just feels like, you know, just wanting to participate in the mess.
Yeah. That's what I feel like. Want to get your name in the headlines a little bit.
Yeah.
It's what she's giving to me. Now everybody is talking about this one. Jaden Smith coming up and goosing Justin Bieber, and then
the Biebs
kisses him on the cheek.
Justin Bieber kisses him on the cheek, like, "Hey, girl, long time no see." You know,
right?
That's how I interpreted it. I don't know what they said
like that way.
Allegedly, "Hey, girl."
He rubbed his little pita on his cupcake.
He did. On his tea cakes. I don't know if he even got cupcakes. Tea cakes. On his tea cake. Is this a deal? Is this a deal? Are people just like, they're getting a lot of like gay bashing for doing this?
Yeah. I mean, they grew up together. So this is probably just them just being playful and stuff like that. Like, I don't give any credence to that. But, you know, people want to see what they want to see, and they want to believe what they want to believe. And, you know, my thing is, this is why this kind of stuff always gets me angry, because it's always like, okay, well, they must be gay. They must be gay. Well, okay, and what about it? What if they are? Like, why is that? It's always the, you know, being gay is like the worst possible thing you could be. Like, and I just don't like that narrative all the time. But, you know, this is the world we live in, and that's the way. Yeah, it's just, Sammy says, reuniting, and it feels so good.
Hey.
I kind of do it a little bit. I mean, to me, I just think this white guys just don't have a problem being themselves, period.
Right. You know, it's always the, like, you know, you cannot show any type of emotion, you cannot show any type of affection toward another guy. And if you are, then y'all must be gay.
Mm-hmm.
Blur wanted that big black cop.
Blur Forever says Jake is good anyway. Probably shagging a lampshade or something, so let him live. Yeah.
I didn't expect
Justin shagging a lampshade. Shagging a lampshade.
William Boy, what'd you say?
I didn't think. I was kind of shocked that Justin Bieber was that affectionate. Like, because what he had, the hothead.
True.
Yeah. But if, like Swag said, though, if they grew up together in the industry and whatever and hung out, as you know, they're really legit friends, you know,
they've been friends for a long time. So I look at it as just, they're just two friends, and they just, you know, they're just being just themselves.
There's just two friends just bumping pocketbooks. That's all.
Lord have mercy.
Not,
let me tell you something. I play football. Men do worse. Let me tell you, you should just okay.
Mm-hmm. All the titty grabbing and ass slapping.
Yeah, swinging around and all that.
Did you see how forceful he pulled him in, said that, "This is my pussy." Yeah, this is my pussy.
This is why Beyonce says no camera at her parties. This is because you don't want to worry about people misconstruing casual encounters to end up on page 6, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about some hot cream, and what we're going to talk about coming up is something that I think John is going to have a strong opinion about, because John is a Sportsnista. And so I, you know, really hang around the periphery. I am not a Sportsnista at all. But let's take a look here. TS, the Shade Room, is reporting that Angela Reese and Caitlin Clark's salaries have been revealed. I took a look at all the girls' salaries that they had out there.
Travis.
Like, none of them is making, like, more than somewhere in the range of, like, 330 to 350, 370 total for,
yeah, like, that's years. Over, like, 5 years.
5 years. It's like, wait, they're making, like,
5 years?
Yeah, they're making, yeah, like, $74,000, $75,000 a year. No,
yeah.
They're, yes. Right. They're making under $80,000 a year to play in the WNBA. Somebody, right, said, y'all need to go get a real job. Somebody wrote me coming.
They make more money from other things too, so they got a lot of endorsements. I know because Angel Reese has a lot of other endorsements too going on for herself. So that's not all. That's just like one of her streams of income is basketball.
Yeah,
but here's the thing though, the Indiana Fever that Caitlin Clark went to. Do you know what the payroll is for the entire team?
What?
Only $1.5 million, which is less than what a first year NBA male player makes.
Right. Now the question is, how much money is the WNBA pulling in? That's the next question. Like, are they raping these? Sorry, I'm gonna use another term. Are they lowballing these women? Or are they paying them what they can afford to pay them?
Let me just put it like this. The math is not mathing. Because they are pulling in numbers. They are pulling in fans. But according to the NBA, they're not pulling in numbers and they're not pulling in fans. So the math ain't mathing.
Mm. Right. I think it mathed a little bit to me.
What's the matter to you, sis? Tell us.
Because I don't think people, like, even though it's popular, like, people like to watch the girls play, women play, but it's not, like, think about the numbers, like, compared to, like, the men's NBA. Like, mm-hmm. They were already selling next season, selling suites. I mean, but like, we went to a game, like, okay, for example, I went to a Mavericks game and I went to a suite. That whole suite was like $10,000 just alone. You know, they not selling suites.
But let me ask you this. How many WNBA games do you see on TV?
I don't recall hearing about none of them, really.
Exactly. It's the networks that bring you in the money. They won't put them on TV. Mm.
But I kind of feel like that's going to be changing soon.
Because, it's going to be changing. It is. It is.
Yeah.
It is.
Because, like, with just like the women's college, you know, tournament, like, they were saying that, like, they were bringing in numbers bigger than some of the men's games. So it's like, it's I feel like it's getting there. I kind of agree with John. It's not there yet, but it's approaching that. So I kind of feel like, you know, once that starts happening, then okay, you need to start paying these ladies what they do, because, you know,
I think
they're about to enter into some collective bargaining, so it should change.
Exactly. And like, you know, and like Junior Boy said, you know, they do have like their endorsement deals and stuff like that. So, you know, they will be making some money, but I do agree, like, they should be making a lot more.
When I
saw those salaries, I was like, bitch, you telling me I make more than Caitlin Clark makes right there? Really? Wow. That made me feel some kind of way.
For you to be, and they're gonna have to work, and then they gotta practice, like, they practice.
Right. I just sit here in this comfy chair and I'm just like, you know.
Do you all know when it's changed now, but when they used to travel, you know, to other cities to play, do you know where they would put them up?
The Motel 6
in, or the, like, in the Super 8 motel, and they had to share a room.
I would never.
They was on the chilling circuit. You know what I mean?
Seriously, that don't make no sense. Mm-hmm. Chandler says they pay what they can.
Chandler.
Same as saying,
keep in mind, that's why Brittany Griner
ended up going over to Russia. Yeah, you're right. Sammy says, hold up. They're bringing in millions, but only allowed to earn something that almost equals their tuitions. That ain't fair. I agree. And Shannon says, the NBA helps subsidize the WNBA.
Not enough.
And Gilly says, that's wild. I agree. That's crazy. They need to start doing like women's soccer players. Like they need to hold out and be like, nope, you need to pay us what you pay them.
That's what they gonna use their pussy power soon. They gonna
get it. Well, that's a shame. I hope they get what they're worth, because pay them what they're worth. The, you know, it ain't got to be nothing more. Just pay them what they're worth. Pay them what they've earned, what they're helping to bring in. Don't be getting rich off their backs and not making them rich too. You know, that's just right. That's just how it should be. But
I agree.
Here we go. Congratulations to Kid Cudi. Kid Cudi has got engaged. Now, can any of us name one Kid Cudi song or feature that he's on?
Absolutely not.
It's a no for me too. Noah, can you name one? Can you name one?
I think I might have said his name on a couple of features, but
anybody in the audience, can you name one? Don't Google it. I see you right now.
You see,
I could name a show he has on Netflix, Intergalactic. He was part of that.
He was part of it. Okay, that's something. Okay. Gilly says
day and night. Ahead. And Elliot says Balmain jeans.
Balmain.
Oh, like the designer. Balmain. Okay. All right. So y'all didn't Google that, did y'all? Y'all didn't Google that, because I don't know none of that. But I was just trying to keep it young and fresh and throw somebody in there that the kids might know. So there you go, kids.
Congratulations on the engagement. You know?
Yeah.
The little animated feature that he has on Netflix, Intergalactic, is actually pretty good.
Oh, it's really good. It's very, very good. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I loved it. I watched it three times.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we got Brandy is reprising her role as Cinderella in Disney's Descendants, The Rise of the Red. Kudos to Brand. Kudos to her. Keep making that residual checks with Disney, girls. Just keep on getting that money. So congratulations to her. Okay, so we're going to move into this next segment. You know, I really enjoyed last week's when we did, yes, Elliot, she is the queen.
Mm-hmm.
When we did
Shy.
Listen, you don't have to DM her shots.
If you don't want to make any enemies, do not say anything negative about Brandy. I'm telling you right now, my bestie is gonna come at you if you don't correct this thing the right quick.
Like we said, the John statements do not reflect not even the opinion of this panel. Much less M3, baby. Okay.
I knew it was coming. Ellen said, now, wait a minute now. Not too much on Brandy.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Fun fact, Elliot has met Brandy in person. Elliot has met Brandy. And she actually followed him. He met her at one of her concerts, and he posted something on Instagram, and she followed him. And that was like, he was so excited, and I don't blame him, because you know he knows I love Janet. And if Janet had followed me on Instagram, I'd have been like, I would have died. So
I met Monica when she came out with Boy Is Mine CD and hugged her and took a picture. Okay,
Wait, girl, ain't nobody talking about Monica right now.
Ellie says, you're in Greensboro, John. That's my hometown. I will come find you.
Elliot, I too met Brandy after a performance of Chicago in New York on Broadway. She was the sweetest thing. I took a picture with her too. Brandy's so sweet.
I
did too.
I got a picture on my phone right now. I met her at Juneteenth in Dallas. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think the
we've all met our people. Move along.
Yes. Let's move on. Let us move on. So Black, Queer, and Proud. So Spotify has a playlist of Black queer artists that you can go find on your Spotify playlist. So if you're like, hey, I need some new artists to listen to, you can find this playlist and scroll through, and maybe you'll find somebody you haven't listened to before or in a while. So Black, Queer, and Proud on the Spotify playlist. Can y'all read some of those artists from there? I put my readers on so I can see it. So name some of the artists you see in the top six there.
I see Joel Curry and what is that? Emnique.
I've listened to some Emnique before. I don't know.
I don't even know who that is.
Alani, I listen to all of them.
Lil Nas X, Jack Harlow, Frank Ocean,
Victoria Monet.
I don't know. Victoria Monet.
Oshi. I don't know who that is. If I said that right.
Victoria said, oh yeah, I like girls too. Like, girl, do you really? Like, just because you will kiss a bitch, but do you eat pussy? Like,
right. A little experimentation is like, nah, you don't really get to make that. You don't get a toaster at the gay agenda meeting for that. So sorry.
Yeah, they're all Black artists.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Sammy says, are these by Black queer artists or perceived what we would listen to?
I don't know. Maybe a little bit of both. But they are Black queer artists, though. Everybody in there is Black. a little bit of both of what you're saying there. So these are a few must-read books. This is from, y'all remember Penguin Books? This is from that publisher. There are must-read books by queer Black authors. So let's look at we're going to look at like four titles here. We're going to take turns reading the synopsis. And John, you'll start first if you don't mind. And here you go.
The Taking of Jake Livingston. Well, I'm on my phone, so it's real small. So give me.
Oh, that. Okay. So you want somebody to pick it up for you?
Okay, go ahead. I can see it. 16-year-old Jake Livingston sees dead people everywhere, but he can't decide what's worse: being a medium forced to watch the dead play out their last moment on a loop, or being at the mercy of racist teachers as one of the few Black students at St. Clair Prep. Both are living nightmares he wishes he could wake up from. High school soon becomes a different kind of survival game, one Jake is not sure he can win. Go ahead, Jake.
The Taking of Jake Livingston by Ryan Douglas. So there you go, people. Looking for something to read? This gives us a spooky.
Uh-huh. Wait, what are they taking from Jake? His pussy, or are they taking his life? What are they taking?
John, you would have to go there.
I don't know. You got to read the book to find out, John. They're not going to give you anything.
Okay.
You got to read the book to find out what they're taking.
Okay. You all right, Junior Boy?
Yes. I just, you brought me down to a low skimmer.
Now, this actually sounds like a book I'm going to put on my list to read. Like, I like supernatural stuff. I like the fact that it's reality. He's dealing with racist ass teachers. I'm here for this. I'm here for this. Give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down.
I hope one of the ghosts just haunts one of the racist teachers. talk to one of the ghosts. Be like, take care of this fool for me, please.
So, what do y'all think? Is this something that would pique your interest to read, or no? Or this doesn't do it for you?
I'll add it to my list. I'll add it to my reading list. This does sounds interesting.
Junior Boy, yeah,
it does sound interesting because, like I said, that's why I was like, what are they taking? Because the way them eyes are poking out, you know, you would thought you got stuck with no Vaseline. So that's why I gotta see.
So bad.
Thank you, Sammy. Thank you. All right. Swag, take this next one, please.
Sure. Right Where I Left You by Julian Winters. Smart, swoony, and pitch perfect, Right Where I Left You is ideal for every reader who's just as likely to geek out over a new issue of Superman, Son of Kal-El, as they are the quintessential meet cute. I feel like that's what it says. Like the thought is incomplete. Yeah, it feels incomplete. But Leah Johnson, best-selling author of You Should See Me in a Crown and Rise to the Sun.
Mm. What do we think? This doesn't make me want to go rush to get her. She's giving me too like juvenile. Yeah, she's giving me Saved by the Bell energy.
It's giving like Love, Simon. It's giving, you know. Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't.
Maybe I'll buy it for my niece.
Right. Like, here, girl, you know, open your mind. Here's a little gay love story.
Yeah. The title gives me something of, like my ex, Right Where I Left You, right there in the damn dirt.
John, all right, Junior Boy, take this one, please.
The Late Americans by Brandon Taylor, a novel about friendship and chosen family. The Late Americans ask fresh questions about love and sex, ambition and precarity, and more, and about how human beings can bruise one another while trying to find themselves. It is Brandon Taylor's richest and most evolving work of fiction to date, confirming his position as one of our most perceptive chronicles of contemporary life. What's
Late Americans, Brandon Taylor.
It's a no for me.
I don't know. I might be just like pick my land or something.
I'm not really interesting.
I don't like anybody. I don't like anybody that's late.
Mm-mm, no. It's probably me, like, about the chosen family. Like I kind of like that idea. So that's piquing my interest a little bit.
The chosen family, the love and sex. I'm here. I'm gonna give her a thumbs up for me. I will add this to my list to check out.
All those things: love, sex, and money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Let's see. Here we go. We got here. Ooh. Quietly Hostile by Samantha Irby. Quietly Hostile makes light as Irby takes us on another outrageously funny tour of all the gory details that make up the true portrait of a life behind the screenshotted depression memes. Relatable, poignant, and uproarious. Once again, Irby is the tonic we all need to get by. She lost me at memes. At first, I was really kind of into this. Is she talking about memes? We see on the internet doing a book on memes, girl. Like,
that's what it kind of feels like. That's what it kind of sounds like.
Girl, this sounds like you figured out an easy way to make a book, bitch. to write a book. But I'm all for supporting the queer and the blacks, but this is a no for me. What about
y'all? Is that a skunk?
It is a skunk.
I mean, the stink.
And the skunk seems quite hostile, so I mean,
it's silently. You got two no's.
I like stuff that is funny, so you know,
you give it a chance.
I'll take a peek.
Now I'm gonna let you take a peek and you tell me how it is. Never
said a picture book.
It is a picture book with comments.
So that should make it a quick read there, right?
Junior Boy, what do you think?
No.
I mean, I'm all about supporting it. I mean, writing is hard. Writing is difficult. I just finished a draft of my play, Yaya and the Golden Throne. Are you interested? Yes, yes, yes. And I've been sending it out to people. Actually, just did a copyright application with the U.S. Copyright Office, so don't try it, anyone. And she's already gone out there. The government has her. And so, you know, hey, we shall see. Writing is hard. So I hate to shit on anybody's writing, but, you know. People gonna shit on my play probably if it gets that.
Well, there's writing and then there's writing. So
that's true, right? That's true.
The writing. We'll see.
Yes. Very, very true. So we are flying through this episode. We are flying through this episode and we are already. I know you're like, oh my gosh, really? Cream already? Yes, baby, already. We are here for Throwback Thursday. And this, I feel like this is somebody we all miss dearly. And there's so much happens in the world today. And we're like, oh, I wish she was here. And that is our girl, Wendy Williams. Back in 2008, the Wendy Williams Show premiered. And like many of you, we probably thought this woman's a hot mess. This show will never make it. But we thought it's a hot mess. It'll never make it. She's too messy. Not even messy in the way she's speaking, but just everything. And and she's not herself, because at first she was trying to be too PC-ish when she first started. But she they gave her a chance. She found her footing, and eventually, must see TV. That's because I'm hungry. I had oatmeal for lunch, but I don't tell them.
You know, oatmeal.
I know, girl. It was what was in the office, and I was like, I think it was this morning. I put on my shirt, and I was like looking at my stomach, going, "I gotta do something about you, girl." And so I was that was me just trying to do a little something about her today. Mm-hmm. But yeah. So we miss you, Wendy Williams, so much. What do y'all miss most about the Wendy Williams Show, if anything?
I'll start with topics.
Yes. Hot topics. Yeah, go ahead, John. No, it was great. Yeah.
Hot topics.
Yes. This is a hot topic.
I like watching her after show. Her getting ready, her after show, her getting ready before the show, live show. I still like
watching her little YouTube thing she would do. Yeah. Or yes. Love that.
Memorable interviews like the one with Omarosa, and you know, just some of those memorable interviews. But that one sticks out.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Swag, what about you?
I never watched Wendy Williams. Don't come for me. The only thing I know about Wendy Williams is the "How you doing?" Like, that's the only thing I know about Wendy. Like, I just couldn't. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I hope that doesn't make me a bad gay.
It honestly gives you a demerit. It gives you a demerit. It's a demerit, honey. I can't. I mean, it's a demerit. I mean, I'm not going to say it doesn't take away your card, but I question your judgment.
I got a strike on my record now.
You got a strike on your record. Definitely.
Yes, next time I go to the game, the meaning, they're going to be like, here she goes.
Well, James, I wouldn't give you one, Swag. I wouldn't give you the merit for that. Not for Wendy.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
For Wendy, after all the years she was on the air, it's a demerit, yes. But at least checking it out, he ain't checked out one episode to see what the gays are talking about. Like, no, unacceptable. At least James down here went to YouTube. Okay, like I'll give you that, James. You went to YouTube. That's fine. She came on during the day. You work. I get it. You know what I mean? You're not looking for it. So it's okay. It's all right. Sammy, oh my gosh, the hedonism in the comments today.
Thank you, Sammy. Thank you. I appreciate that. See?
No, Sammy gets a demerit too. He gets a demerit too. Yeah. Hit that gong again. Hit that shit. You get a demerit too.
No, I'm giving him a ding.
Now do your due diligence and go back on YouTube and look at all of my past episodes now.
Oh my goodness.
No, you gotta do all that. But anyway, you know, she was a major part of our pop culture moment, and I hate that she went out the way she went out. That, to me, that's the worst part. That she went out in such a tragic way. You know, her husband leaving her, her going through that, the fainting spell, which was kind of like the beginning of the downhill after the divorce and stuff. And it's just like, I just hate, and now her being in the situation she is now, you know, I feel sorry for her. Now here we go. Uh-oh. See, this is not it. I wasn't looking for him. I mean her. I was just fantastic. That
is transphobic to me. You know, whatever.
Yes. Okay. Right. Transphobia in the house. Just kidding. Transphobia's not funny. And don't come for me. You don't know, because I could be trans too. You don't know. So. Don't be saying
you're not trained. Okay.
But people in the audience don't know that.
I'm here to tell you.
All right. Well, that's going to conclude the main portion of the episode. We're about to head into the after show, after party. Over there, where we gonna talk about some old things. What are we gonna talk about? Don't worry about it, because you ain't coming to the after show. So if you go to the after show, you will know. All right. But thank y'all for listening and watching. We really appreciate the support. And don't forget, Swag, can you do the thing where you go through the shows? Because I'm really bad at that.
Absolutely.
I'll be going right to goodbye.
Okay, well, coming up for the rest of the week, join us on Saturday with Greg, Saturdays at noon, where he will go through the Black News, the recap, the reach around, and all sorts of other shenanigans. So that's going to be Saturdays at 12. Then join us on Sundays at 5, where hopefully Devon will not cover Good Times again so that he does not get reprimanded.
Devon can do whatever he wants to do on his show.
Devon. The girl. I know, but if you are looking for talk about anime, comics, especially X-Men 97, I definitely know they will be talking about that. So you will find that on Sundays at 5. Join Greg and Malcolm. I don't think it's on here. Let me switch over to another panel real quick and just bring that up. So you can see the midday mornings with Greg and Malcolm. I keep wanting to say that the wrong way, but there's a lot of M's in that. So you can find them Mondays, usually around noontime, but it's always good talk. It's always good talk with them. And then check me out on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Where I talk mostly about stuff I find on TikTok, Twitter, social media, all kinds of crazy stuff. And you'll also see what T'Challa is watching. You can check out Malcolm Wednesdays at 7, where he gets into mental health, relationship stuff, just, you know, and some thirst traps. It's always a good time. So that's Wednesdays at 7. And of course, we got to give a shout out to our good friend John here. You can catch him on Instagram at @_double_j_chronicles on Instagram. And join us back here next week on Thursday, where Mr. Diggler will get into the entertainment that you know and love. Right back here at Thursdays at 8 o'clock.
You can watch my beard slowly come back week after week. See how many weeks it takes to me to start looking like myself again and not like somebody's pastor. Or like a milk dud. Some mouth balls, something.
You are still our sexy librarian, Cream. So
come on, Pastor. Come on, Pastor.
My girl say though, she do look young though. She do the gray dude. She do be looking young. He look young.
I know.
She got round
for you.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, we're gonna go on, head on out of here. I'm gonna get you these credits, and we're gonna see y'all over on the other side. Bye bye.